Hey everyone, it's Clutch from Off Grid Ojai. Thanks for tuning in. Hey, sorry this got out late. As I was doing the editing, the music just wasn't working for me, and the Africa thing worked for Tanzania, but I just thought, you know, you can't do the same thing twice, so I had to mix up the music, so it took me 5 more hours. So I hope you like it. Here we go. So we start off leaving Tanzania. The first big tip is this is the most stressful day because this flight can actually make like 5 stops without changing before it gets to the border if you don't get the right time. So I was calling every day, you know, 3 days before to see what the schedule was like and what time we'd have to leave because I didn't want to get a flight that was going to make a lot of stops, and we actually got a non-stop. You know, I think the squeaky wheel gets the grease, as they say. So here we go. Leaving Tanzania was awesome, but this part of the trip is amazing. Rwanda is in the center of Africa. It's much more wet. It was a center for all kind of agriculture. It was a kingdom before with a king, and it's called the Land of 1,000 Hills, as you can see there. So we land in a place called Manza to go through passport control and then off to Kigali. So we stayed at the Serena Hotel. It was the nicest hotel for sure for the longest time. The Marriott had just been completed. I didn't want to take a risk because I knew, you know, people who had been here, and I just felt like this was tried and true. But I'd probably try the Marriott from this point on. It's newer and probably has consistency. So the next, that day actually, we only spent one night in Kigali. Your guide and me too, and we went to the Genocide Museum. It's really well done. They not only do the Rwandan genocide, but they also talk a little bit about all genocide events. And anyway, as you know, this is about the Hutu and the Tutsis. The Hutu were 75% of the population. The Tutsis were the minority, but they ruled the area for a long time, and they were supported, I believe, by the French. Anyway, what happened was the leader of the Hutus was shot down in an airplane, and the Tutsis were blamed. And after that, they went on this rampage, and again, there was this militia made up of basically, you know, young teenagers who were indoctrinated and basically were sent out to, quote-unquote, you know, find the cockroaches. And they killed priests and teachers and politicians, you know, as single thought, trying to wipe out the other side. Anyway, today they have really done a lot with the country. I feel like it's one of the cleanest countries in Africa I've ever been to. They have this thing called National Cleaning Day, where every Saturday, not every, but one Saturday a month, everyone goes out and cleans their area, which makes sense, even the president. And, you know, it's kind of a social policing. You know, if you're not out there a couple months in a row, that, you know, your neighbors are gonna go, what the hey? Anyway, after the Genocide Museum, we went to the Enema Art Center, where we met these amazing artists who also teach young orphans about art and to become artists. If they have talent, they'll even, it's like an orphanage almost, they put them up, help them, feed them, and teach them how to create art, which is a great thing. I met this great guy, his name is Innocent, that was his first name. I'll never forget that, and I've got a picture with him coming up. Anyway, it was a really cool place to spend an hour or so, and talking to the people there, you really got a sense. There's Innocent on the left, and our friend Fern, who we met in Cambodia, Vietnam, and traveling with us. Anyway, so the next morning we take off for the Volcanoes National Park. And we only spent 2 nights, so if you want to do 2 days of gorilla trekking, you've got to do it this day you arrive. So it's a 3-hour drive or more through winding roads, so we took this helicopter, which was amazing. Some people, you know, might not want to do that because they're people fly in helicopters, so I understand. So you have to leave really early. So you arrive, you went straight to the ranger station where you're kind of assessed and your gear and your fitness, and you're assigned a group. You know, we didn't know what to expect, so we went with an easier hike the first day, which was lower elevation. It was a eucalyptus forest, and you can see the mist, the gorillas in the mist, and Diane Fossey's volcano where she gave her life protecting these gorillas. Anyway, so they assess you. The first day, our hike was relatively easy, and the next day, we made it more strenuous. It was amazing. So you arrive here, there's 25 families that you can see, and there's only, you only see two groups a day, so that would be 50 groups, right? And there's another 30-something families that only are studied or left alone. So gorillas don't sleep in the same place every night, so the trackers have to kind of follow them until they bed down, and then they can radio in where they're going to be the next morning so they know how far they are. So this is the camp, the ranger station, where you get assessed, and we actually just walked right out of the back there and, you know, walked up this nice meadow and started a little easy elevation, there it is, maybe a mile, and then went into this eucalyptus forest. So the first day was in the eucalyptus forest. Gorillas don't drink water, amazingly, so they go to different areas of the mountain to get what they need, and they get all of their water from the vegetation that they eat. So they eat almost all the time. You know, they make it look easy, but they're ripping apart branches and tearing off bark that you'd be lucky to do with a saw. So we come up on them, and, you know, this was kind of good orientation because it was more open and you could see them at a distance as you kind of approached. And, you know, it's a little bit, you know, exciting. I mean, it's exciting. I wasn't scared, but it was, I didn't know what to expect. And so, you know, I forgot to take a lot of video this day because I was just so, you know, focused and enthralled by everything and how close they would get and how, just observing them, you just lose time of what, you know, oh, I have to take a picture, even though I got a lot of pictures. Just the emotions on their face, you can tell they're intelligent, and, you know, they look at you, and you're really close. It's very engaging, authentic, emotional, just enriching. It's just, it was... This was really what made this the best trip of my life. I mean, you're literally sitting with these gorillas for an hour. The families can be up to 30 large. There's usually one large silverback that's the boss, and then, you know, there's maybe 10 females and 10 adolescents. And so it's a troop, pretty good size, and you don't see them all at first. And so first it's the females and the adolescents, and then the big guy comes. And so I, you know, this guy's huge, and I'm a little bit apprehensive, you know, I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do. So they tell you that you're supposed to always kind of crouch down and, you know, be smaller than them and don't look them in the eye if they're looking at you, or if they seem to get agitated, don't stare them down. And they, you know, told me some language to use. The hello term was ma'um. So I was practicing that and everybody was laughing at me, but I used it on this trip and they actually responded to me. You know, the guides that are the guide and trackers say, you know, they can tell if you're nervous or if you're aggressive or if you're not, so they kind of size you up right away. And once they realize you're friendly, you're cool, then, you know, they go about doing what they want and they might even come over and check you out. So that was really just amazing. So there's a lot of babies in this troop, and, you know, you don't see them sometimes because they blend in, but they're, you know, on the backs or on the stomach. And so this big guy starts coming up to me, the first big silverback. I mean, there are other silverbacks that are like young adults or other adults, but they're not the main guy, who's usually the biggest guy. And so everybody kind of makes way, and he comes up. And I'm just going, wow, is he going to come over here? And then he stops to tear apart a tree with two fingers. And just they're all around me. They're behind me, in front of me. It's just exhilarating. I mean, sometimes I'm just not sure where I'm supposed to watch. Trying to get artistic there. Their hands are so much like ours. And when they stand up, they look, I guess, that, you know, Bigfoot, but they, you know, they look like a large human. And the kids are so much fun. They just frolic and run around and play all the time. They always want to come and play with you. So the big guy's coming up, looking at me, sizing me up. It's a great shot. So I'm just like, wow, this is, how can it get better than this? And it does. So he comes over, I'm like, my heart's beating, but I'm relaxed because I'm, you know, I'm committed, right? The only thing you can worry about is when you decide not to go. That's what I always say. You can decide not to go, but once you're going, you know, you're committed. Anyway, it was great. So he comes over to me, and I get down, and I try not to make sudden movements. And I don't have my video camera on, and I'm afraid to put my hand up. It's on my head, strapped to my head, to turn it on. So I'm kind of taking photos eventually with just from my kind of chest, my icon is around my neck, and I'm just kind of taking the pictures from the hip right now as he comes close to me, and I'm just on the other side of the tree, and he just starts eating the bark right in front of me. And I didn't get a video, but you can see how close he is. The camera, I'm not focusing, I'm just taking pictures. And then he turns his back on me, so I guess I'm cool. I'm not a threat. Anyway, so after that amazing first day, we go back to the hotel. It's not that far at all, maybe 30 minutes. And it's the Basati Lodge. It's only 6 units. They're all suites. Comes with like a living room, fireplace area, bedroom area, and a bathroom area. Here's some great shots. They're all like little cocoon huts. And they've got like a main kitchen dining area and a spa and kind of media room, wine room that you can watch your videos and pictures that you take that day. So we arrived there, you know, relatively early. I mean, we got to the gorilla place in the morning. The hike was very close, so we got to see the gorillas quickly. And then, you know, you only get to spend an hour with them. And then you come back, and so we were able to have a late lunch and dinner with entertainment. Really fun. And the food's great. And you talk to all the guests at the bar, their experiences, because every troop is different and every hike is different. And so I tried to request a more strenuous hike, the mountain that Diane Fossey was on, and it's a bamboo forest. I was really, you know, doing my research, and I think they appreciated that. So I think that's why we got to go there the next day. So it was a much longer drive, I would say over an hour, you know, to the kind of jumping off point. And you meet your porters there, and they're walking sticks. They carry your water in your bag. And this was like what I pictured, you know, really lush and thick and bamboo. Really cool though, not scary. I thought there were going to be a lot of like mosquitoes and you see bugs, but nothing bit me. They're just kind of like butterflies or moss or flies that don't really even land on you. So you hike through. This hike was about 5 miles round trip. And one of the guests had this kind of GPS that he kind of plotted our course, which is kind of cool on a map. I should have got a copy of that. But anyway, it was 5 miles round trip, but it is, you know, thick terrain. So we meet the trackers there. This is near the Congo. And they kind of orient us on where the gorillas are close, because these are the guys that follow them at night. So the I want to talk about the Congo, but I guess I can. So we meet these gorillas, and they say they're here, and I'm like, where? And they're all around us. I didn't realize that they're in front of us, behind us, above us. And suddenly, you know, we walk a little bit further, and they just start appearing everywhere, you know, and jumping all around. You just like don't even know what to do. And there's like where they kind of slept the night before. They don't sleep in the same place twice. I said that. So, you know, that's their nest right there. And so eventually the guide says, do you want to go in there? And I'm like, what? While they're there? And he's like, yeah, crawl in there. And so I do. But it's just amazing. So this is close to the Congo. My cell phone even said, welcome to the Congo. So that's where the, I think it's the RFP, the people that used to be in power, not in power, but were accused of shooting down that plane. They're there now. Most of the Tutsis fled to Uganda. There are 800,000 died. And then the Uganda invaded back, and now there's, you know, the new president who, look, you know, you've got to have some authority in order to get kind of peace and just law and order. So, you know, he's accused of doing some tough things, but, you know, it's a tough place. But it's very safe and very clean. We talked about the, you know, cleaning day every Saturday. Anyway, I'm going to let you watch this a little bit. These are some great shots. The gorillas, you know, we spend an hour with them, and they're just all different ages, and they want to come over and play with you and tug your jeans. Oh, that's a good story. So the guide, the ranger, says, you know, if they like you, if good karma, they're going to come over to you and try to get you to play with them. So, but don't go, he says, you know, because they're just too strong. And so, you know, they can come over and touch you, but you can't touch them. And I said, okay. And then I said, oh, you mean stripper rules? And the guy laughed, because I'm going to use that the next time. Anyway, so we're just hanging out. They're just all around us playing, coming up to you, you know, checking you out. And they look you right in the eye. But they don't, like, hurt you or punch you. They're very gentle, you know. And you can just, the adults just kind of check you out. And they know, you know, you're no threat. You don't have a chance against them. Unless you have an AK-47. So this guy's just lounging, falling asleep on his back in the sun. A big silverback. That's my friend Robert. This big silverback just walks right over him. As he kind of, this is when they're kind of starting to head out. Our hours, you know, we're about at 40 minutes maybe right now. And the group starts to kind of gather. When the big guy gets up and starts moving, everybody knows they're going to move because they're going to go to the next place they're going to sleep. For that night. And so then the trackers, you know, with the army uniforms will follow them until they bed down, and then they'll radio in the GPS coordinates for the next day. Otherwise, you can never find them. You, not never, but you'd spend most of your time looking and might not even find them. So you're pretty much guaranteed, not pretty much, you're guaranteed to see them because they know where the 25 families are. So this is where I kind of crawl. I don't know if I got the video of this, but I crawl into this, like, nest. It's like a kind of a tent of leaves and branches. And there's, like, a mom and a baby down in there, a really young one. And so I go in there. I guess I just take a few pictures. yeah, so... yeah, this is just really crazy because there's one above me. Yeah, there he is. And so I couldn't concentrate on it because I kept hearing something really close to my head. But again, you know, I'd never felt in danger at any time, and I can't tell you the type of experiences. Is there's an experience like no other. The amount of adrenaline, it's not even adrenaline, but just the feeling you get, it's just amazing. Like, you know, something you never think you'd have the opportunity to do. You know, it's just... the gorilla permits are $1,500 per person per day, so it's not cheap. So for two people, for two of these things, it's $6,000. That's why, and the hotel's expensive, so that's why we had to really try to do it in two nights. And, you know, there's other things you can see, but after this, it would have been anticlimactic. There's like a special kind of golden monkey and other, I think, chimps. But this was quite an experience. I mean, the pictures that I have, I mean, this is just a fraction of the content. I went through 1,000 pictures. And I should have took more video. Next time, I know, since I'm a YouTuber now, I'll be sure to have better video. I have better pictures than video. So this is cool. When they start to leave, you know, this the big guy they're playing, and eventually they'll all kind of group up, and this one kind of adolescent comes from my top left and just swings right by me on a vine, and then they start screaming and twirling by me, and they all kind of walk away, and we kind of follow them out because they're in the same direction that we're going to get back out. But it's, here we go. So they're all kind of getting ready to go. Like, I don't know how they know, but they're getting ready and we're just hanging out. They're behind us. It was kind of like Jurassic Park, that movie where when they first see the dinosaurs, when we first, and they come running all around you. It's like when we first saw this group, and you didn't really see them because it wasn't like the first day where you can see them coming. They were already around us and we didn't even know it. And then suddenly when they felt comfortable, they just started coming out all around us. And it was that feeling where, whoa, these guys were all here and just flying, swinging, jumping. It was just quite a scene. So they're kind of gathering up and they're going to move to wherever they're going to sleep or what they're going to eat next. They eat most of the time. Like, the guide told me to try to pull this bamboo shoot out of the ground, and I couldn't pull it with both hands and my feet. I was pulling it, tugging it with all my weight. I couldn't even get it out of the ground. And so he cut it with a knife, and then I tried it. It was really, you know, it's good, the bamboo shoot, Chinese food. Anyway, so we come up on this gorilla, and he's just chomping him down, and with two fingers and a thumb, he grabs his bamboo shoot, like the kind I was trying to pull out with both hands and both feet, just rips it out of the ground with two fingers and just starts chomping on it. And I'm just like, whoa. Like, look at those arms on these guys. I mean, they're just like as thick as my whole body. These guys are so, look at that. He looks so humanoid, like. Just amazing. I mean, they are right there. Like, I could touch them. I did touch them. They touched me. Wow. This brings back so many memories. Travel is so enriching. The wealth of memories and experiences and perspective that you get and the appreciation that you get of where you live and the opportunity to help others. You know, you learn a lot. We'll talk about economics and how they get their rice and their crops to market. And because it's similar around the world, whether it's Cuba or Cambodia or Rwanda, the problems are very similar, you know. In a lot of these places, you know, kids don't have shoes to go to school, you know, and running water in their houses, you know, and they're trying to get water all the time. You know, so it really disappoints me that, you know, our country has so much and we have so much and we waste more than the rest of the world uses. And, you know, the protesting and everything that's going on is, you know, if everybody knew and stepped back and realized how lucky everyone is, you know, I think we could all solve the problems peacefully, you know, because, wow, that's my favorite little shot there where he twirls around. So again, you know, I think there's a common thread in all of these videos where I think, you know, the future is in the youth and the children. And, you know, what happens and what we have to try to stop and avoid is the indoctrination of children. They're growing up in fear of global warming, fear of pandemic, fear of, frankly, other races, fear, you know, and that is how they're indoctrinating the kids and how they will try to control in the future. And this has been shown in Rwanda and Cambodia and in Cuba, Vietnam. So I really hope that we can all come together and, you know, it's up to us as a community, as I've said in earlier videos, and parents and teachers and big brothers and coaches and uncles and aunts, anybody that the kid looks up to, you know, we have to help to show them proper respect of others and to not repeat the mistakes that have been made over and over again. And this was 1994, Hotel Rwanda, where the GM of that hotel, I think he must have been a Hutu, you know, harbored a lot of people and saved their lives. Our driver was one of the people that was kind of hiding in the Hotel Rwanda. He was a Tutsi. Anyway, so the people are very happy, but they're struggling. They're very poor, and wish that they could have what we have, I'm sure. So the future's within the kids. I hope you're enjoying Off Grid Ojai. This channel is a little special because I do get into kind of current events, but I think it's important that, you know, we think about things. So again, thanks for tuning in. See you guys next week. Clutch at Off Grid Ojai, out.